Hello everyone, I am Professor Balkishta Reddy, Professor of Law and Registrar, Nalsar University of Law. Today we are going to discuss IP protection for outer space activities. I am going to look at four important aspects of today's lecture. I will begin with what is IP law, why we have to protect intellectual property. Then second component will be international space law. Third, I am going to look at how many treaties the component of international space law IP protection is there. Then finally, I am going to look at how India is implementing space activities relating to ISRO and other organizations dealing with this. So, to begin with, what is IP law? IP law is defined by different people, but according to me, very easy definition is IPR. I stands for intelligence, P stands for property, R stands for protection. IPR. If you have something from your intelligence, human mind, it becomes your property, you have to protect that property. That is a whole discussion on the intellectual property rights. So, IP regulation, coming to the regulation, why we have to protect intellectual property? If we don't protect, what happens? Yes, IP regulations are very important. Before I talk about IP regulations, I'll talk about why we have to regulate. What do you mean by regulation? Regulation is an authoritative direction to bring about and maintain order in society. Whether it is the land, sea or outer space, protection of order is important. So, here we are going to discuss about the IP protection for outer space activities. IP law. IP law basically are IP regulations. We can look at four important aspects. One is national regulations. Second one is bilateral regulations. Third one is regional regulations. Fourth one is global or international regulations. I am going to look at IP regulations in India or national regulations. Every country, if you look at today, we have around 200 sovereign countries are there in the world. Every country has their own IP regulations. In India, we have 7-8 important IP regulations like Patent Act, Trademark Act, Design Act, all those. Similarly, other countries also same. So, every country has to protect their intellectual property rights. Of course, why India has to protect its intellectual property in general or relating to space activities, I will discuss later. Second component of IP regulation is bilateral. Today, most of the intellectual property regulations are regulated through bilateral mechanism. When I say bilateral mechanism, two countries. Bilateralism is based on principle of sovereign equality. If I extend this facility to you, extend that. That is the whole purpose of the bilateral regulations. Lot of IP are regulated through bilateral mechanism and particularly in outer space activities. For example, India has a almost 30-35 important bilateral agreement relating to other countries on protection of space activities in general, including the IP protection. Third component is regional regulations. Lot of IP is regulated through regional mechanism. When I say regional mechanism, we have a regional organizations like European Union, NAFTA, OECD and etc. All these organizations also protect, preserve intellectual property. When it comes to outer space activities, we have a European Space Agency. That is the organization among the European countries which protects intellectual property through its directives, what we call European Parliament, European Council of Ministers. They regulate generally IP and including the intellectual property relating to outer space activities. This is the third component. Fourth component comes the international IP, IP regulations. Basically, international intellectual property law can be looked at three important aspects. One is Paris regime, other one is Bern regime, the third component is WTO TRIPS agreement. When I say whole intellectual property or international intellectual property can be looked at understanding around 25 important international treaties which regulate international IP law. Here I am going to look at only three important aspects covering all these 25 treaties. One is Paris regime, I call. What do you mean by Paris regime? Paris regime consisting of Paris Convention 1883 and other conventions dealing with three important aspects of intellectual property, that is patents, designs and industrial property. So, this is regarding the Paris Convention. Though the Paris Convention is a mother treaty, rest of the patent designs are based on the Paris Convention. Then second major component is Bern regime. Bern regime deals with copyrights, particularly copyrights relating to authors and other people, but Bern regime now including neighboring rights also, what they called copyrights and neighboring rights. So, that is the second component. But today, international intellectual property has assumed lot of importance because we in the 21st century living in the knowledge society. So, knowledge is important. Whatever you impart knowledge, you need to have protection over that knowledge. That's why third component WTO TRIPS GATT WTO TRIPS agreement is important. What is a GATT? General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade 1947, though it is not supposed to deal with the intellectual property rights, since there is a WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization, to look into that. But however, few components or few sections of the GATT 1947 discussed relating to IP, for example, non-discrimination, MFN treaty, Article 9 talks about the geographical marks of origin, etc. But that is not the job of, you know, TRIPS agreement. Next important component is WTO GATS. WTO agreement is one of important agreements among the trade and intellectual property treaties. WTO is not a one treaty. WTO consisting of 180 agreements part of that. But I am going to look at here one important agreement, TRIPS agreement. TRIPS agreement is the agreement dealing with the international intellectual property rights. So, when I say the agreement, all the earlier Paris Convention, Bern Convention, some of the important provisions also now part of the TRIPS agreement. In a lighter way, people say that TRIPS agreement is nothing but copy paste and cut paste of Paris and Bern conventions. If that is the case, why, if these provisions are there already in the Paris Convention, Bern Convention, what is the need to talk about a other international treaty? Question comes. Of course, friends, if you look at Paris and Bern conventions, though they are, you know, oldest treaties, they have a excellent provisions. One important lacuna in the Paris and Bern regimes or Bern conventions were lack of enforceability. That is the one flaw, one lacuna. To overcome that and effective enforcement of international intellectual property, part of the Uruguay round, part of the WTO, now we have a TRIPS agreement. TRIPS agreement, most important agreement, it consisting of 73 articles divided into 7 parts. All these are all important, I am not going to look, but various categories of intellectual property provided in the TRIPS agreement. First part deals with the why IP is important, how IP can be protected, what are the obligations of member countries when it comes to, you know, IP protection. But the second part deals with Article 9 to 36, deals with various kinds of intellectual property, including patents, trademarks, designs, geographical indications, etc., part of the TRIPS agreements. Of course, one, you know, major thing, how countries implement these treaties, question comes. For example, India is a party to all the treaties, whether it is a WTO treaty or earlier I mentioned, you know, Paris Convention or Bern Convention, India has to implement these treaties. One flaw in international system is, international system does not have its own machinery. It has to depend on the countries. That's why countries have to implement. So, it is true with India. So, India, since party to Paris Convention, Bern Convention, TRIPS agreement, India has to implement, and we are implementing through having enabling legislations or specific domestic laws we enacted. Already some laws are there, for example, Patent Act 1970, but we made amendments in tune with, in compliance with, in consonance with the TRIPS agreement. So, like incorporating those provisions, updating the international IP regime into domestic law. This is brief about the first part. I'll come to the second part, protection of IP for outer space activities or space law. What is space law? Space law in simple words, or according to my view, body of rules governing the use of outer space. That is what I call space law. So, how this space law evolved, or how to understand quickly the development of space law. So, again I can look at entire development of space law in three phases, three components. One from 1957 to 1963, second 67 to 79, third component 80 to present. So, before I talk about the space law, I will speak few minutes about the space technology and space law, the linkage between the law and technology. When we talk about, you know, IP protection for space, how space technology evolved, when it evolved, what is the beginning point for this. So, the space activities started in 1957, that is called 4th October 1957, first satellite Sputnik 1 was launched by former Soviet Union successfully. After that, many countries including United States and other countries also launched space satellites successfully. Few of the authors called space era has begun with this 4th October 1957. We call space era or space age. Since then, from 1957 to present, if you look at last 5 to 6 decades, so much of development. After, you know, 4th October 1957, we talked about the, you know, Yuri Gagarin was the first man in, you know, space, then Neil Armstrong, then we are today talking about, you know, colonization of space, space tourism, buying and selling of property in outer space. If you look at interesting thing nowadays, you know, it appears in papers that, you know, if you want to buy flats in outer space, we will give. That is the, you know, thing. So, what I mean to say that technology has developed a lot for all these 5 to 6 decades, tremendous developments, all these technological developments. Here question comes, I am here to talk about the protection of IP for outer space. What I have to do with the technology? Of course, since technology is developed, that technology has to be protected by the author or person who was responsible for that invention or discovery. So, this is regarding the outer space. When it comes legal aspects, actually, I just mentioned the space law, easily understanding three important aspects. I said one is first phase, that is what we called soft law phase. Soft law means non-binding. Most of these law developed by United Nations. For example, in 1957, I said 4th October 1957, 14th November, exactly 48th day, the United Nations General Assembly passed a resolution asking, urging, requesting the countries use space for peaceful purposes. That was the beginning, I can say, space law. After that, 1958, 1959, the UN General Assembly passed many resolutions. Mostly, initially, if you look at, you know, first phase, what I said from 1957 to 1963, non-binding in nature, only requesting countries to, you know, adopt, to use this space technology for peaceful purposes. Why I am using these peaceful purposes is initially both former Soviet Union and United States of America launched lot of satellites keeping in view of making outer space as a war zone. So, that's why international community was cautious about saying that please don't use outer space for weaponization or, you know, war zone. So, use space for peaceful purposes. Friends, here when I talk, say about outer space, one thing you have to look at is outer space is global common. You know, there is a property, two kinds of properties are there actually, one called res communis, res nullius. Res communis means community property that belongs to everybody. Res nullius means belongs to none. So, outer space is belongs to global community. Every state has a stakes in that outer space property. That's why whatever comes from outer space, it has to given to the other states also, because everybody is part of that. So, that's why outer space is a global common. When you use this global common, caution is that you have to use in a prudent manner. You have to use in a very, you know, useful. Don't harm, don't pollute. That was the caution they have, you know, international community or particularly United Nations has urged all the states or, you know, requested all countries. This is regarding the first phase from 1957 to 1963. Many resolutions passed asking countries to use outer space for peaceful purposes. Second phase, what I call 1967 to 79, is hard law. Hard law means treaty, binding force. Most of the countries party to space treaties. If you ask me, you know, what is the important component of space law? Present day body of outer space consisting of five important treaties. For example, Outer Space Treaty 67, then Rescue Agreement 68, Liability Convention 72, Registration Convention 75, and finally the Moon Agreement 1979. These five treaties constitute the core corpus of space law. Entire global or international space law consisting of these five treaties. Out of these five treaties, the most important treaty is Outer Space Treaty 67. This is what we call mother treaty of outer space activities. If you look at this treaty consisting of like 13 important articles, but for space activities, protection of outer space, I refer two articles. Article 1 says outer space is the province of mankind, it belongs to everybody. Use and exploration outer space should be free for everybody. That is the, you know, provision there in the Outer Space Treaty or Article 1. Article 2 talks about non-appropriation, means you have a right to use outer space for peaceful purposes, but you don't have a right to colonization of that outer space by way of occupation, use and other things. Here, when we talk about the IPR protection for outer space activities, these Article 1 of Outer Space Treaty and Article 2 of Outer Space Treaty are contradicting each other. First treaty, Article 1 talks about the free for exploration, anybody can come and, you know, explore, but various second article talks about non-appropriation. This is, we can debate out. Now a lot of debates are going on that, you know, how to maintain balance between the Article 1 and Article 2 of Outer Space Treaties relating to this IP protection for space activities. Other treaties like Registration Convention is very important when we talk about the protection of IPRs. When I say registration, which, you know, the country which is sending satellite has to register, then the country has sovereign rights over their personnel, their, you know, equipment, their, you know, satellites, etc. This is where again the other component of intellectual property relating to outer space is important. Then we have a Moon Agreement. 1979 Moon Agreement also talks about the IP protection for Moon and other celestial bodies. One important provision in Moon Agreement is Article 11 of the Moon Agreement talks about Moon and other celestial bodies are common heritage of mankind. So this is again, you know, principle which contradicts the intellectual property rights. So since the corpus of space law developed from 1967 to 79, that time IP, particularly outer space IP, was not a issue, but today it is not so. Recent past, if you look at again third phase, particularly after 1980s, lot of developments are happening in the space arena. Particularly when I say generally globalization, liberalization, privatization, commercialization, all these things are happening all over the world relating to economics and other things. So space arena is no exception to this. So the globalization impact has been impacted on the outer space activities. Particularly lot of private participation is happening in the outer space activities. So when private ventures are happening, how to protect intellectual property is a big question. So that is where today a global community is pondering about that protection of intellectual property for outer space activities in keeping in view of the recent commercialization and privatization activities. Next comes particularly developing countries. Here there is a lot of dichotomy between the developed and developing countries. For instance, most of the existing space law, or for that matter any international law, developed by developed countries to protect their own interest. If somebody is making law, means they will see that their interest has to be protected. Most of the space treaties what we have today are developed by developed countries, keeping in view of their own, their self-interest. That's why today most of the developing countries are asking that we don't want, you know, the law which you made. So we want some concessions because we are developing countries. Second important aspect we have to look at when we talk about IP for space activities. Today already thousands of satellites already there in the, you know, outer space. Today space debris is one of the major issue global community is facing. Space debris, I mean defunct satellites. After sending satellites, after lifespan is over, then they will remain there itself. They won't come back. So already now space is becoming too much congestion. But if look at most of the developing countries are not utilized outer space. So we are planning to send more and more. Of course, not India. India is an exception to developing countries. Most of the other developing countries, even they haven't launched their satellites. How to look at that? If space, outer space is belongs to everybody, then every nation has a rights. But this is where other important dichotomy between developed and developing countries are happening. So India, of course, I said no exception. If you look at Indian space activities, India started being a developing country, its activities in 1963 from Tumba rocket launching station in Kerala today. So that is, you know, in 1960s, we began with, you know, familiarizing outer space, how to understand outer space technology. 70s, we made some satellites, then 80s, like that. Today, India, of course, last 60 years or so, or 50 plus years, India is also sending a lot of satellites. Though India is a developing country, but sometimes we are surpassed developed countries. For instance, 2 years back, India has sent 104 satellites in one go. It never happened in the space history. Earlier, Russia sent 37 satellites in one go. But if you look at India, 104 satellites we sent in one go. Not only these, out of these 104, most of the satellites are from developed countries. These satellites we, you know, launched from developed countries. Here one again commercial issue is there. As long as you send your satellites, you do your activities, no problem. But you are, you know, launching satellites of other countries. So how to protect, you know, if something goes wrong, what is the rights they have, what is the liability to be discussed? All those issues are part of that now. So in India, I can say remote sensing, launching satellites are important business components. Indian space technology has moved from scientific era to commercial era. When I say scientific era, scientists did lot of work, you know, they sent satellites, and today lot of, most of the today what we use, whether it is a cell phone or, you know, a computer or internet, all are, you know, happening through satellite technology only. So this is, you know, good thing about space technology is that whatever humanity is enjoying the positive benefits, that is, you know, done by various satellites. So this is major thing we have to look at. But when it comes negative side or other side is business. So India or other countries also, but I'll speak about India, has moved from scientific era to commercial era. When I say commercial era, now just now I gave example of launching satellites. Even India is selling lot of our remote sensing to countries like America. So when you are selling, when business is involved, then there is a need to have a law. Actually, in India, we don't have any space law at all, domestic. Though international space law is the outer space treaty, other treaties are there. India is a party to all important treaties. Today, a lot of pressure is on India that India has to implement international space treaties. So India need to have its own domestic law. Here, very interesting thing comes. When I was doing my research way back in 25 years, I started, you know, writing saying that India needs space legislation because commercial activities started. When you don't have a law, it becomes difficult for, you know, courts also to interpret. Generally, the role of courts are to interpret law. So if law is there, they can say good and bad or right, wrong. But we, if law is not there, how to continue with this business or this commercial activity? That question came. That's why I started last 20-25 years. My research is India needs space law, including IP law. Today, since we don't have any space legislation, there is no question of IP protection. So in my writings, I mentioned that we need to have a space legislation because commercialization is happening, because India is involved with, you know, $1 million business is doing with other countries. Then we need to have a law. That was one of my, you know, strong arguments for last 2 decades. One is we need to have a law. That law should take care of all these private participation, commercial activities, and, you know, other things. Second component, today I am arguing last few years that not only we need specific space law, but we need that law should protect also IP activities. For example, India is being a developing country. We are putting lot of our hard earned money into the space activities. Once you put, you know, your money into outer space activities, if you don't protect these space activities, or if you don't have IP protection, tomorrow other country may claim that this is mine. That's why we are, you know, we have to be very careful when we engage in these space activities. Particularly today, ISRO is confronting, facing some problem, how to protect this intellectual property in outer space activities, whether it is the patents, whether it is the designs, whether it is the trademark. All these issues today, we are, you know, having a problem. Of course, we have our legislations, but those legislations are general in nature. For example, we have a Patent Act 1970, then we have a Designs Act, we have a Geographical Indication Act, we have a Copyright Act, all these things. But these are general legislations. These legislations are, you know, enacted earlier. But today, space activities is a recent activity. So there is no protection. I'll tell you one example how, you know, space activities are very important. Normally, India, we have a, this is comes under domestic implementation. When we say that, you know, I mentioned India is a party to all these 5 important treaties. I will again repeat for, you know, your reference: Outer Space Treaty 67, Rescue Agreement 68, Liability Convention 72, Registration Convention 75, and Moon Agreement. India is a party to all these agreements. So India has to implement all these agreements in domestic context. How we have to implement these agreements? And second thing I mentioned just now, problem with international law or international space law is it does not have its own machinery to implement those. So it has to depend on countries. For example, India has to implement these. How we implement international law in general, or international IP law, what I spoke about, Paris, Bern, all, or international space law is a question. So yes, being a party, your obligation is you have to implement. How we have to implement? There are 2 important theories when we talk about the domestic implementation of international IP law or international space law or international law in general. 2 approaches. One is monism and other one is dualism. India and most of other countries follows dualism. Means we are, I can give an example. India believes that international law and domestic law are 2 different distinct bodies. If at all international IP law has to implement in India or international space law has to implement in India, we need to have enabling legislation or supporting legislations. That is one important thing. Then today, though I just mentioned that we don't have a space law, but other space related or including IP related activities today regulated by other legislations, including a constitution. So one major problem with outer space activities is, though being a federal state, most of the international issues are dealt by federal government or central government. We have a, you know, division of powers between center and states. For example, important like central list consisting of 97 plus state list. And what I am trying to say that the outer space related activities are part of the central. The interesting thing is when Indian constitution adopted in 1950, outer space was not a issue. Space age, I said just now, is begin in 1957. So that's why there is no mention of space activities in Indian constitution. So how to implement these things is a big question. So there is a provision in the Indian constitution. If anything is not mentioned in the constitution, based on Article 248, that's called residuary powers of the center, along with entry 97, we can include any new thing. That's why the entire domestic implementation of international space law in general and the domestic implementation of outer space, protection of space activities, particularly based on the constitution. So this constitution actually we incorporated based on Article 248 along with the entry 97. Today, most of the space activities are part of the central based on the constitutional provision. And since 1950, it was not there. After 57, we incorporated all those outer space related activities part of the Indian constitution based on these two provisions. Based on that, today we are implementing international space law. However, one lacuna is that we do not have a domestic space law. So it is the need of the hour is that India needs space law. Again, I will repeat this thing. India needs space law because commercialization. So I just mentioned that earlier, my writings for last two decades, I was talking about the protection of IP in the national space legislations. So fortunate thing, recent developments, if you look at general domestic space law in India, we have a space bill. Government, after putting lot of efforts by lot of writings, people like scholars like me, last 25 years, 30 years, we are making efforts to implement international space law through a domestic law. That law is now in the pipeline, but it is not yet became a law. What we called Space Activities Bill 2017, that is the bill that is pending in the parliament. Once that bill passed, we have some provisions which they can protect the IPR relating to outer space activities. Though this is a niche area, upcoming area, but it's a lot of scope is there for researchers in this context. I hope you enjoyed my talk. Thank you. Thank you very much.